It's Sunny and Finn's Games and Graps podcast. This week, we go over the games of February, give our thoughts on the Royal Rumble and NXT TakeOver San Antonio, and give our predictions for this Sunday's Elimination Chamber.
What's up, guys? Welcome to episode 50 of the Games and Graps podcast. I'm Sunny, and with me, as always, is Finn Steele.
Hello.
We've made it.
Time. Yes.
We did it. I'm so happy.
We're halfway to 100.
Yes.
My God.
50 podcasts deep. Did you think we'd make it to 50 when we started this little podcast just over a year ago?
I don't know. Don't think so. I mean, at first we were like one a month. And yeah. Then we did slightly more often. And then we started to do it weekly.
Yeah.
And yeah, we've come a long way.
We have come a long way.
Yeah. It's been good.
It has been really good.
Good one.
It's been a lot of fun. We've had a lot of laughs. I mean, you can,
yeah.
If you go back and listen to these podcasts, or if you have been listening to them this whole time, we've had so much fun.
So much fun.
Yeah. And we've built a YouTube channel off of this.
Yep.
Sunny Finn Play, which has been great as well. We've got our regulars who come along to there. We have neglected it a little bit fairly recently, but we've been preoccupied with doing sort of daydreamer stuff. But
yeah.
We will still be doing the wrestling stuff on there, so
of
that's
course.
Still going. Yeah, it's been a good time.
Good time, yeah.
Awesome. Over the last year or so.
Yeah.
I'm very happy.
Me too.
Just, let's thank some people.
Okay.
So thanks to Steve for joining us numerous times.
Yes, thank you, Steve.
Gaming Mule, who's been on.
Mm-hmm.
Dan Hinkles from Five Star Wrestling, who's come
course.
On.
Awesome.
And congratulations on your success with your wrestling promotion that seems to be doing very, very well.
On Spike TV.
Yes. Mm. So it's very good. Very cool. I'm very proud of those guys. And I appreciate that they came on to speak to us a long, long time ago.
Yes, very cool.
And everyone else, and everyone who's going to be sort of helping us going forward, including all the Daydreamer guys and all that sort of thing. And it's, yeah.
Yes, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. Who listens to the podcast, of course.
Yes.
Who tweets us and everything, all of that sort of stuff.
Very cool. Yes, thank you very much.
We very much appreciate it.
It's Griff, Martin Dixon on Twitter.
Yep.
He sent me this awesome Persona 4 badges.
That's yes.
Very nice. Thank you for that.
Chris Walsh, they always he always tweets us about the wrestling and video games, actually. There's Retro Revelations or Revolutions. Apologies if you've listened to it. Is it Revelations?
Something like that. I think so.
I'm going to look.
Okay.
I'll look. So I don't want to thank somebody and get it wrong, because that's really shitty, especially for somebody who takes time.
Yeah, I think it's Retro Revelations.
Certainly not Relevations.
Renovations.
let me just double check. Retro Revelations. I was right the first time.
Yeah.
There we go. Good.
Also.
Thank you to all of you guys. Your support has been amazing, and keep supporting us, because we really, really do appreciate it.
Yes.
We will keep making podcasts as long as you guys keep listening.
Of course.
Finn.
Hello.
Let's start the show as we always do.
Okay.
What have you been playing?
A lot more of the same, really. Playing a lot more Resident Evil, of course. Still making videos on that.
You getting on?
I'm getting on pretty well. I killed a few bosses. I won't go too deep into it because of spoilers. But
of course.
It's a very cool boss fights. Very cool part where you're chasing, as a spoiler, chasing a little girl around.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's like lots of cool stuff happening around you, especially in VR. In VR, it's so cool.
Oh, so you're, again, not to spoil it, but you are near the end.
I'm getting there, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm getting through it. I think one more session will I'll finish it off.
Good.
So that's fun. What else? Play more Paper Mario. That game is really long. I thought I started playing that. A while ago, thinking this would be a short game to blast through. I'm still going now. Jesus Christ. I mean, it's still fun, but you can end now. I'd be happy for it to end now.
Have you noticed how we've got older that is like happening more often? Like when we were kids.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I bought this brand new game and I don't want it to ever end.
Yeah.
But now I'm playing through games and I'm thinking, I'm ready for this to finish now.
I've got
a massive backlog of games I need to get through.
Keep getting bigger.
This is dragging on. Come on, it's been great, but come on. Then you realise you're only 8 hours in and you're just the most impatient person of all time.
Yeah. Other than that, just more the same, more Overwatch and all that fun stuff. And yeah, I'll tell you, I'm playing a game called Downwell. I put it on sale for like £1.50. I believe it's like a mobile game to start with.
Okay. What's this on?
It's on PS4.
Okay.
It's basically like a roguelike little game, a little platformer, but you're going down a well, hence the name. And you pretty much just collect power-ups and trying to survive, keep going deeper and deeper and down as well. And once you die, that's it. You start back from the beginning. But you like learn from mistakes and carry on and get better power ups and all that. It's very cool. Cool game, worth checking out. It's very cheap.
I'll just download it off your profile, to be honest.
Of course, yeah, you can do that. Or Black and Drapey too.
Did you ever buy Dragon Quest Builders?
I have, yes.
Oh, you did buy it?
I bought it, never played it. Because
good, right? That's
I will definitely play it, probably.
I might look at it at some point. I'm just interested in it because it looks colourful.
Yeah, I love the demo. The demo was amazing.
So shallow. Oh, it looks colourful, I'll just play it.
The colours, yay.
Yeah.
Pretty colours.
Yeah, I'm the kind of idiot that likes picture books and not... Yeah, so that's why I read comics and not actual books.
Yeah. Oh, this one got pop-up book, yay.
Yeah. Oh, there's a picture of Batman.
Batman.
Don't know the words.
Yeah. You punch man. But yeah, all that fun stuff. What have you been playing?
I beat Resident Evil.
Nice.
And I really, really enjoyed it.
Cool.
I won't go into it and spoil it. It was very Resident Evil-y, but in first person.
Yep. That's what I love about it.
Them little tricksters over at Capcom. But I enjoyed it. I thought it was great.
It's so cool. I love it. Have you tried it in VR yet?
Only the first bit. Like, only sort of the bit from the demo, I think.
Cool. If you play through it again, I highly recommend VR.
Okay.
It makes it so much better.
And I've been dipping in and out of different things. I mean, I've been playing The Division. Started that again.
Nice.
Started playing it on stream. I played some Batman Arkham City. Ooh. I'd neglected that a little bit.
Oh, yes. I saw you, actually.
Did a stream of that, which was great, actually. Cool. Over on Daydreamer, which was really, really good. And, God damn it, my vice has come back.
Oh, no.
You know what it is?
What's that?
Destiny.
It's
again.
Back. It's back.
And I'm playing it on PS4 this time. I realised I had the digital version on PS4.
Oh, yeah.
That son of a bitch. I was like, I'm going to stream Destiny.
Yay.
And then I didn't. I streamed Batman instead. But I do plan on streaming Destiny. So it was a fact. It was when we played the beta for Ghost Recon. We were talking about The Division.
Yeah.
And we were talking about how that's not as good as Destiny. And I was like, no. You planted that seed in my head. I was like... Destiny. It's like I just need to play it more and more. I just love it still.
It's a great game.
Yeah. It rules. So I've been playing a bit of that, but then I've been dipping in and out. I've been playing some FIFA and some other bits. I haven't really sat down and played anything since I finished Resident Evil properly. I will do. I need to sort of get some games out of the way. So I'm gonna finish Batman. I need to get into Yakuza. I've still got your Walking Dead season 2 to play. I've bought Kingdom Hearts, which I'm 100% certain.
Kingdom Hearts 2.8 final chapter prologue?
That's the one. And I have played like an hour or so of it. Nice. And it's pretty cool, but I'm not sure when I'm going to get back to it. I'm probably going to play the remasters before I even get into that.
You should.
I mean, I played it and I'm like, okay, this is cool. Characters are pretty fine. Then I have no idea what's going on.
Yeah.
Where's Donald Duck? You know,
I'd highly recommend playing the first two first, just so you can get at least some bearings, get into it.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna. It comes out back end of March, so I'll just play it then.
Yeah, they're great games as well. So good.
But I've got it. It's added to my collection. So
cool.
That's pretty much what I've been playing, really.
Excellent.
We don't really have much in the way of gaming news, because we haven't looked.
Yeah.
We won't beat around the bush about it. Just tell you the truth.
Slow
couple of months for gaming news. We did sort of report some stuff last week, but this is last week's podcast because last week's podcast didn't work.
Pretty much.
So we're re-recording it afresh with fresh material, and I can't be asked to retrace last week's news because chances are, if you're listening to this, you already know.
Yeah, pretty much.
But we are going to go through the games of February, as it is the first podcast of the month.
Yeah.
And of course, we do have a jingle to go along with this segment.
We do.
So, Finn.
Hello.
You just made the list of games that are coming out in this month.
Yeah. Okay. So, we start with February 3rd. We have Poochie and Yoshi's Woolly World on 3DS.
Which looks very pretty.
But yes, I believe it's just a port of the Wii U game, I think. That's sure if it's a new game completely.
It must be downscaled a bit.
Probably.
It has to be.
Yeah, sure.
It has to be, doesn't it?
It's a cool game. We'll play it on Wii U. Lovely, simple little game.
Okay.
Lovely graphics. Worth playing. For sure. Bunch of PC games I won't go into because, Jesus Christ.
So many PC games that come out.
Yeah.
Especially, you know what, actually, Steam before garbage. We get into this properly,
okay.
I want to talk about something here.
Okay.
There was a game that came out on PSN yesterday, and I'm not having a go at the game itself because I haven't played it, but it's called... It's a dating game, basically. It looks like a mobile app. I did tweet about it.
Okay.
And people sort of, you know, liked my tweet about quality control or whatever. But I can't believe the games that get released on PSN.
Yeah, it's becoming very Steam-like at the minute.
It is.
People notice that, yeah.
I mean, the guys who follow us on Twitter, the Xbox reviews guy.
Oh, yeah.
He was like, you've got to give the little guys a chance. And I do appreciate that. But there has to be a degree of quality control that goes into this, because I saw that game and I just instantly, I was like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
It's called Kitty Powers Matchmaker.
Oh, yeah, I saw that as well. I was like, oh, for God's sake. It's like one of the front store pages, like front page.
I know.
I was like, what? Why?
And now Kitty Powers is, again, I'm not having a go at this person because I don't know who they are.
Yeah. Some American.
Is a transgender. Well, she's not a transgender at all. It's a guy who dresses as a woman and portrays the character Kitty Powers.
Right.
Again, I'm not having a go at this person because I've never heard of them until yesterday.
No.
But, like, this person has around 3,000 followers on Twitter.
Okay.
So, let's assume half of those followers, or less than half of those followers, own a PS4.
Mm-hmm.
Or an Xbox One, because it's coming to Xbox One at some point.
Okay.
That game would have cost money to make.
You'd have thought so.
Sony will take a fraction of any sales that it gets.
Mm-hmm.
How many sales, realistically, is this game going to get? I mean, I'm basing this person being an internet personality.
I think so. I don't know. I don't think she has her own TV show, I think. I think I've heard of her before in some weird form or other.
Right.
Yeah, I think she was on some TV show in America. I have no idea what it would lead to. Maybe it's a dating TV show. Who knows?
Okay.
I we should have done research, but
I mean, I looked at it and it was sort of like cross-dressing gamer person.
Oh, okay. Maybe I'm thinking of someone else.
And when I saw it, I was like, right, okay, you've got 3,000 followers. This game's coming out. It's £10. How many people are actually going to buy that game and how much money is it going to make? Is it even going to make what it even costs to make?
Yes.
Somebody at Sony has to really take a look at the games that they're bringing out or allowing to be released on the store, because these games aren't going to make any money.
Yeah, there's been some weird games on there. There's a game recently called something like Life of Black Tiger.
Oh, yeah. That's exactly what it was called, I think.
Yeah.
Life of Black Tiger, yeah.
It's an utter garbage game, yeah. Just bad translation, bad everything. Look it up if you haven't seen it.
And it's had a universal panning as well. This isn't just so us taking to this podcast to slate these games. They're bad games.
Yeah.
I mean, I've not seen any reviews or anything for this Kitty Powers matchmaking game, but it looks like a mobile game. And that, for me, is the correct platform for those type of games.
Yeah. Oh, and it was. Available on the App Store and Google Play and Kindle Fire.
So it is a mobile game.
It is.
Turned into a PS4 and Xbox One game.
It is.
For me, that shouldn't be happening.
I agree. Different you know, platforms have their own strengths.
Most people have a smartphone these days.
Yeah.
So if they want if they want those games, you know, like Candy Crush and Farmville and that sort of thing, and you know, that's fine. There's a market for that.
For sure.
But I don't think that market translates to the home console market. Like, I wouldn't want to sit on my PS4 and play Angry Birds.
No, yeah.
You know? So again, I'm not having a go at that game, and I'm not having a go at Kitty Powers. I just don't see where how these games get onto PSN in the first place.
It's definitely a weird one. This game got quite good reviews on Steam, apparently. So
what was Kitty Powers Matchmaker?
Yeah, apparently so. But yeah, it's a weird one. It's not PS. I know PS4 and Xbox One are, you know, the right places for these kind of games. But I don't know, if it sells well and does well, then well, good for it, I guess.
Hey,
I
mean, more power to it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I've got nothing against it. It's weird that it would be on, like, front page on PSN. It's clearly not, like, one next to Overwatch or something like that. It's like, it's not signed a game. People not, you know, same
it's a very niche
Overwatch is gonna be.
Type.
Exactly.
You're hitting very a very specific audience with that game.
Yeah.
I mean, you and I are going to look at that, the front page of the store, and go, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
Why am I interested in this? Then you click on it, you see it's a dating game. It's like,
well, I am out.
Well, that's £10 I won't be spending.
Yeah. It's a weird one.
If somebody wants to give me a code for Kitty Powers Matchmaker,
we'll play it on stream.
Maybe this will reach Kitty Powers herself or himself, whatever. If it does, and you want us to play this game, we'll play it on YouTube.
Yeah, we will.
Reach out.
We'll give it a go.
Reach out. Prove us wrong.
Reach out and judge faith. What?
That's been a nice personal Jesus reference.
Yeah.
Anyway, back to, you just made the list
yeah.
of games coming out in February.
Okay, so speaking of PC, WWE 2K17 comes out on PC. today, in fact. So, oh. Yesterday, in fact. So, yay for that. Yay for PC gamers. You can now play a bad wrestling game.
The problem with it coming out now in February is that it's even more out of date.
It's weird.
I don't understand. I know if you're going to bring it out at the same time. Because, I mean, it's already horrifically out of date when it comes out on consoles.
Yeah, seriously.
So the fact that PC have to wait even longer. I mean, it's February now. The game came out here on, on consoles in October.
Yeah, yeah.
So you've got another 5 months of WWE added on top of that.
Yeah, but weird time to release it. But, hey.
They also released a preview of the upcoming showcase mode that they're bringing out as DLC.
Oh, yeah.
Which I'm interested in. It looks pretty interesting. They're going to add some more characters in that and the showcase mode as well.
That'd be interesting.
I don't know when it comes out. I'm assuming very soon.
Hopefully. Interesting. One to keep an eye on.
Sure. I mean, we're going to have to play that game on Sunday.
Okay. Well, yeah. We will.
yay for us.
Elimination Chamber. Right. Also, on February 7th, Neo finally came out on PS4. PS4 exclusive.
We have it.
And I'll be streaming it tonight after the podcast recording is done.
So you can go and check that out at Daydreamer Gaming.
Yep. I look forward to that. On February 14th is a game called Deformers Shrug on PS4, Xbox One and PC.
What is it?
I have no idea. Let's have a look. Open up my new tab.
Deformers? Is that D hyphen Formers?
Exactly.
What is that?
I've no idea. There's very little information at all.
Deformers.
In fact, the first post in this forum is crack multiplayer torrent.
Deformers is a brand new, fast and frantic multiplayer game from Ready at Dawn.
Oh, yeah.
Ready at Dawn, who actually did tweet us at Daydreamer.
Oh, yeah.
Because we, Viz tweeted about The Order 1886.
Oh, that was him.
And they did tweet us. So, yeah, Ready at Dawn are behind The Order 1886, which, by the way, I actually really loved. But
yeah, I didn't know that.
It's not popular among critics, shall I say.
Yeah, I don't know.
This sounds interesting. I mean, it's a physics-based arena brawler where the goal is to out-battle, out-eat, and outscore your opponent. Smash up your friends in split-screen co-op or team up and fight against each other's online. Actually, that sounds quite interesting.
Yeah, sounds all right. Maybe
we'll
try it.
But we'll have a look at that.
Yeah, cool.
Ready at Dawn if you want to reach out.
If you want to reach out and touch Daydreamer?
Yep.
Give us a bell.
I might tweet them and see if they fancy sending us a code for Deformers.
Nice.
I'm going to do that now while we're reading out these games.
Go for it. Also on the same day, For Honor comes out. Public beta starts, I think, this week.
Yeah, this weekend, yeah.
Cool.
What did you think to it? Did you play it?
I played it briefly, yeah. It was cool. I liked it.
I think it's cool.
It's interesting getting used to. It's, very. I like kind of sort of character action-y, but more strategy involved. Like, got a block in certain directions and attack.
It had, I don't know if you played Rise on Xbox One.
I haven't, actually.
It sort of reminded me of that in a sort of an inadvertent way, just the way that when you're in combat stance, that's the kind of camera view you've got in Rise.
Oh, yeah.
What the hell's that game called? Fall of Rome or something
Rise,
like that?
Rise, Son of Rome, something like that.
Son of Rome, is that what it's called?
I think so.
Great graphics, not a great game.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
For Honor's a really interesting concept, I think, as far as online multiplayer games go.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there's a plethora of online multiplayer games around.
There's so many.
It's like, well, why should you play this? Yeah. But it is actually a very interesting concept. There's different game modes. I mean, I played the beta myself and I did really enjoy it. It's like a one-on-one mode where it's like best of five.
Oh, yeah.
It's quite tactical. It's trying to one-up your opponent using the variety of attacks that you have.
Yeah, you've got different classes and all that.
Yeah.
Like big guy, big axe. So you've got faster guys with a couple of knives.
Yeah, so it actually makes for quite an interesting game. And then you have... like team-based games, so it's like capture the flag mode, basically.
Yeah.
And there's three bases that you have to capture, and you've got AI guys, which help you level up as you beat them up, and then you've got it's like basically it's four aside, I think. Three or four aside.
Yeah, I think it's four aside. Yeah.
And then you've got like an army of AI guys. It's really good. If you check out the public beta, it's an interesting game. I think the game actually releases next week as well. So.
Yeah.
12th of February, I think that is.
14th.
14th. So, Tuesday. So the beta will run all weekend. Game comes out on Tuesday.
Cool.
It's one. To be honest, I am tempted to buy it because it does look quite interesting.
I'm going
to
play it more on the open beta before I make up my mind. Apparently, it does have a single player mode as well. So
oh, really?
Interesting to see what that's like. Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, interesting one.
If you like the open beta, what we'll do is we'll just go house on it.
Yeah, sure. Sounds good to me.
Yeah, cool.
Also on the same day, a game called Ride 2 on PS4 and Xbox One.
I keep saying that's a motorcycle game, isn't it?
Probably. I'm assuming it's not a sequel to Tony Hawk Ride, which was terrible. Once again, no information whatsoever.
Which one's that? Is that the one with the peripheral?
Yeah, yeah. The terrible skateboard thing. What a bad idea. Also on the same day, busy day, Sniper Elite 4 on PS4, Xbox One, and PC.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, that's a popular little franchise we've got going there. Is that the one where you shoot Hitler in the balls? Is that the one?
Yes, it is, yeah.
Yeah, I thought it was.
Yeah. I mean, everyone says how great 3 is.
Yeah, a lot of people like 3.
It's always really cheap as well. I mean, I've always been tempted to pick it up, but I just know I'll never play it, so it's pointless. But This looks really good. Apparently, it's bigger and more open than the previous versions of Sniper.
Cool.
Is it Sniper Elite?
Sniper Elite, yeah.
There's another one, isn't there, called Sniper?
I think so.
Okay, so this is Sniper Elite. This is bigger and supposedly better than the other ones. Sure.
Cool, yeah. On February 21st, Berserk and the Band of the Hawk.
Yeah.
You know the one on PS4 and Xbox One and PC.
What's it called?
Berserk and the Band of the Hawk. No idea.
Okay, that sounds so bad.
On the same day, February 21st, Halo Wars 2 on Xbox One and PC. That'd be good if you liked the first one. I didn't.
Halo Wars?
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, that's another one I'm interested in because I did like Halo Wars. Hmm. I thought it's not usually my kind of thing, but I think the fact that it was set in the Halo universe really had me, the first one.
Oh, yeah.
It looks really interesting and it's supposed to be very good. So this is coming from people who have sort of done beta tests for it and stuff like that.
Cool.
Apparently, it's really cool. Cool. I don't know if I look at it straight away, but it's one that I might look at down the line for sure.
Awesome. Oh, Berserk is apparently based on the anime Berserk, which is cool. It's like a Dynasty Warriors style game, which actually sounds pretty cool.
So I take back my comment of that sounds so bad.
Yeah.
Because to be honest, I was reading my phone at the same time of listening to Finn, so it's just like a nothing comment.
Next game we have is Night in the Woods. Coming out on PS4, Xbox One, and PC. A lot of weird...
Night K-N?
No, night with an N.
Oh.
As in, spending a night in the woods. It's an indie game. That's all I know. Next, February 21st, once again, we have a game which I know well. East Origin, East spelled Y-S. Popular series. It's kind of Zelda-y kind of game.
Oh, you actually like it?
I actually do like
it.
I thought
this was sarcasm.
No, I played them all on PC. They're excellent. Check them out.
Okay. I won't do that.
No, you probably won't.
Okay.
It's a cool game though.
Sure.
Lego Worlds coming out on PS4, Xbox One, and PC on February 24th.
Now, is this the one that's like Minecraft?
Possibly.
Because I think it's... Did you say it's coming out on PC? I thought it was already out on PC.
Good question. It's coming out on PC as well at the same time. Maybe it's in like alpha or something. Or
let
beta.
Me Google it. Because I'm sure, I think that might be the...
Oh, it is. The Minecraft like Lego Worlds, and that's PS4.
I like the Lego games, but I won't be playing that.
Yeah, it's a bit...
9 out of 10 on Steam, apparently.
Mm, very good. Interesting.
People will be amazing at that. They'll be building all sorts of incredible stuff.
For sure. February 28th, big one, Horizon Zero Dawn.
PS4 in America, let's just point that out. We get it 3rd of March.
We do, yes. But that's a big one coming out.
Man, I'm excited for that.
Yeah, same.
That has the potential to be the next big PlayStation franchise.
Yeah.
So much hype behind it. The advertising campaigns are mental already. Yes, and it looks beautiful.
So good.
I can't wait to see and climb up the mechanical dinosaurs and all that sort of thing. I think it's going to be great. I'm very excited.
Me too. And also, I think that's about it for February. A few little PC games which no one's ever heard of. And that's about it.
You just made the list.
You just made a list
of games coming out in February.
Yeah.
Good times.
Cool.
For Honor, I'm, I think I might, I mean, I don't need to play the open beta to make my decision. I think I'm already pretty much
cool.
Sold on it. I'll just wait for you to play it and see what you think. And then,
probably go half on it.
Yeah, we'll just go half on it. Yeah.
Cool. Sounds good to me.
Cool.
Right.
I love that we're getting round gaming that way.
Yeah. Make it cheaper for both of us. Yay.
Yeah.
Teamwork.
Right, let's talk Graps.
Okay.
Let's talk that wrestling.
Good Graps.
Now, obviously last week we went through we discussed the Royal Rumble in depth and the Raw after it and that sort of thing.
Yes.
We're not going to go through it in depth again because, you know, you will already sort of know about it. Plus, yeah. Elimination Chamber is this coming Sunday. So what we're going to do, for the sake of our bets and the predictions that we made going into the weekend's wrestling last weekend for NXT and the Royal Rumble, we're going to skim through the results and then we'll talk about this week's wrestling and look at Elimination Chamber.
Yes.
Which I can't believe is this Sunday, by the way.
It's come by so quick.
Just throwing out pay-per-views.
Yeah, seriously.
It's like, so we've got Elimination Chamber this Sunday. When's Fastlane?
That's, I think, in 3 weeks.
Okay.
Yeah. That's March.
I guess a ridiculously big build. I can't help but feel that maybe Elimination Chamber should be next weekend.
Yeah, that's what I thought as well. The 2 weeks between the little smaller ones.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's start with NXT TakeOver San Antonio.
Okay.
Talk to me, Finn.
Before we do that, I do a bit of random wrestling news for us. A bit of random, but just sort of before coming out. So The Rock and WWE are teaming up to make a movie based on a wrestler's life. If you had to guess who that wrestler was, who would you say?
Well, I would say The Rock, but...
That makes sense. We've had to, well, it was someone who isn't The Rock.
Somebody who isn't The Rock.
A current WWE superstar.
A current WWE superstar?
Yes. About their, a whole movie based on their life.
A current WWE superstar?
Yes.
Triple H?
No.
How? Okay. Do we narrow this down to Raw or SmackDown?
I actually don't know what they're on.
Undertaker.
It's someone who's not currently around, but it's still
hired. A current WWE superstar?
Yes.
Hogan?
No. Current WWE superstar.
Hey, Hogan will be back soon.
He'll be back.
He will be back.
Oh, God.
He'll be back before WrestleMania, for sure.
Okay.
Current WWE superstar.
Yes.
Undertaker.
No. I'll give you a hint. It's a female WWE superstar.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Current WWE superstar. Nia Jax. The Rock's involvement is basically why I guess that.
It's about Strange. It's Paige. Yeah. Your facial expression is pretty much the same as mine was when I first found out about this.
Hang on, is this real news, or are you just coming at me with some nonsense here?
It's actual news that's actually apparently happening.
So WWE and The Rock.
Yeah.
Is The Rock going to be Paige?
That'd be amazing.
They're going to spray him white.
Oh, God.
Hang on a minute. So, to be honest, I was under the impression that Paige was going to be pretty much out of the door with WWE when her contract's up, whatever, because she's doing whatever she's doing with Alberto Del Rio. So now this news coming in is very interesting. Where have you read this?
It's like What Culture. Oh. Wrestling website.
Oh, okay. So, What Culture is fairly reliable. In fairness, it's not like kayfabe news.
No, it's not just some random crap. They've made a video about it on their YouTube page as well. Where I found out about it.
Well, this is very interesting to me, Finn, and I'm taken back by it.
Yeah. In fact, I'll read the What Culture little thing I've got here.
Okay.
Let's see. So Dwayne The Rock Johnson has announced he'll be teaming with WWE Studios and Film 4 to bring a movie about WWE superstar Paige's life to the big screen. The movie is based on the Channel 4 UK documentary, The Wrestlers Fighting With My Family, which was released in 2012 and followed Paige's wrestling family as she impressed WWE officials to win an NXT contract. And Rock is expected to have a cameo in the film, for some reason, and it's directed by Stephen Merchant from The Office.
Well, Film 4 have tweeted it also.
Ah.
Film 4 Insider, huge news. We're teaming up with WWE Studios, The Rock's Seven Books Productions, and Misha Films for Stephen Merchant's Fighting With My Family.
Yes. So, yeah.
And Paige retweeted it herself.
Interesting.
Okay, fine, I guess.
Yeah, very random
that
bit of news.
Very strange news indeed.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. So is it a documentary style or...?
I guess so. Apparently there was a documentary on Channel 4 about only Paige's family. I guess The Rock went to see that and thought, yeah, I can do a movie about that.
This would tie in with Stephen Merchant going to the wrestling in Norwich a couple of weeks back. Because I tweeted from our Twitter account, at Games and Graps.
That's the one.
Merchant loves the Graps.
Oh, yeah, I saw that actually.
And he said, I'm going to some top quality wrestling tonight in Norwich. And now this makes perfect sense. You know who Stephen Merchant is, right?
Of course, from The Office.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so that, that all ties in and makes perfect sense now.
It was also Wheatley. Was it Wheatley from Portal 2?
Yes.
Yeah.
And he did a fantastic job
in that.
It's
amazing.
Well.
Yeah,
I love that game.
Yeah, me too.
Remaster that. I'll play that. I'll play the shit out of that again.
Yeah, me
I
too.
I loved it.
Yeah, seriously.
Okay.
So, yeah, bit of random news for you.
Cool.
That was fun.
And I'll watch that as well. I think that'd be quite... Paige has had quite an interesting life. She's been wrestling since she was like 14 or something.
Yeah, exactly.
And obviously her mum and her brothers and her dad, they're all involved in wrestling. So,
yeah.
Okay, cool. I'm on board.
Cool stuff. Yeah, so, NXT. First match, Ty Dillinger versus Eric Young. Good.
Good.
Big demo is now called Killian Dane. Killian Dane.
Killian Dane.
It's a bizarre name.
Not sure what's wrong with Big Demo.
Exactly. I like Big Demo.
Yeah, me too. It sounds better. It rolls off the tongue better.
It does.
Although Killian Dane does roll off the tongue quite well, but I still don't like it.
Killian. We're lucky Kevin Owens wasn't called like Kelvin Storm.
Kelvin Storm.
Yeah, so like fattiest beard face.
Oh, no.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, I'm recycling the joke from last week. Nobody heard it, so.
Yeah.
So I'm bringing it back up again. So yes, Eric Young ended up winning. Ty Dillinger is excellent. Please don't Tyler Breeze him on the main roster.
Now, do we know if he's even going to the main roster?
I don't know. It's weird. What else is there left for him on NXT?
Well, nothing. Unless they bring in the, which I'm now calling, the Sunny championship on NXT. Yeah.
Yeah. That'd be cool.
I'm going to tweet Triple H later on and say, listen to our podcast. I've been championing this title for a long time.
Yeah.
And now it should be called the Sunny Ghana championship.
You should. Yeah, it was a good match.
My face will be on the title, just so you know.
Can't imagine.
In gold.
In gold. Nice.
Like a pound coin.
So yeah, we both said Eric Young would win that match. So we both get a point there. Ding.
Ding.
Get that quickly. Next match, Andrade Cien Almas versus Roderick Strong. Rodders.
Oh, Rodders. Hard-hitting, very entertaining match.
Excellent match. Both guys are excellent. One little observation is Roderick Strong's finisher is a kick. When he's the Messiah of the Backbreaker, surely you'd have a finisher that would, you know, do, that would focus on the back, maybe.
I'm sorry, Finn, it makes too much sense.
I know, yeah. WWE logic. once again, we both said Roderick Strong would win this match, and he did.
Ding.
Yay. Next, we have the Orders of Pain versus hashtag DIY.
Are they actually called hashtag DIY? Or are we just calling them that?
I think they said it on NXT.
Because there's not like, on their way to the ring, Johnny Gargano, Tommaso Ciampa, hashtag DIY. I don't think they're saying that.
Yeah, you're right. Okay, just throw it with DIY.
But it does say hashtag DIY on their t-shirt.
It does. See, what's it called? DIY. It's fine.
Which I have the t-shirt. It's actually got a rip in the armpit. It's like so poorly made. I mean,
that sucks.
Yeah, it really sucks, yeah. It is like, you know, WWE t-shirts are quite thick material usually.
Yeah, yeah.
This one's not. It's like really thin, weird material, and it's like really long in comparison to my other ones.
Bizarre.
Strange. Yeah. Throw your fucking t-shirts out.
Yeah, seriously. So yeah, another good match. DIY excellent, as always. Unfortunately, we both had DIYs winning, but sadly, they lost to the Orders of Pain. Short title reign, which is a shame, but it was a good match, so... Yeah,
it was a very good match, and I think it's time to start taking the Authors of Pain a little more serious.
Yes.
Just because I think I was harsh on them before, maybe, but I'm a fan now. That match showed that they can work a different style of match other than a squash.
Yeah.
And for that, they have my respect and attention, so good.
Me too. I like Paul Elliman as well. It's cool.
Yeah, he's very, very good.
And then between matches, oh snap, it's Seth Rollins in the ring. What the H?
Oh, shit, son.
And did, yeah, my thoughts exactly.
Yeah, they were the words that left your mouth as when it happened.
It was, so exactly, yeah.
I'm just reenacting what happened in your little house.
A little house, yes. Yeah.
The little house that Finn built.
Yeah, pretty much. So yeah, Seth Rollins was Triple H, and he comes to NXT to find him. Makes sense, good storytelling. Yeah, good, excellent.
Excellent use of common sense.
Yes, well done. The rare bit of common sense from WWE.
Yeah. Don't expect it very often.
Yeah. The Triple H comes down, but then causing security to escort Seth out of the building.
Security, a.k.a. training wrestlers.
Yes. Trainees.
Yeah.
Then we had the Fatal 4-Way Women's Match. Nikki Cross versus Peyton Royce versus Billy Kay versus Asuka. And it was really good.
I didn't like it.
You didn't like it?
No.
Shame.
Because what I wanted to happen didn't happen, so I'm being one of those wrestling fans.
I want those wrestling fans. I want this to happen. Ah. Yeah.
Like every year at the Royal Rumble, when wrestling fans don't get what they want, They just cry about
it. Oh, God, yeah. Especially this year. We'll
and then when that. They think about it, it's like, nah, I can't.
Actually, yeah, it was all right. So, yeah, it was cool. Had a cool spot where Peyton Royce and Billy Kay took Nikki Cross to the announce table and suplexed it off the announce table through a table. That was left to the announce table. Table. And that was cool.
It was cool.
You then saw that stuff in women's matches, so good.
Let's address the elephant in the room.
Okay.
They could have pinned each other and won that match.
They could have done that, yes.
Because they were going to share the title anyway. So why not just pin each other?
Yeah, would have made way more sense. Especially when they had Asuka down outside the ring, had Nikki Cross to a table. That would have been the perfect opportunity to do it.
Yep.
And they didn't.
So whereas WWE hit the mark with the Seth Rollins segment,
yeah.
They missed the mark completely with the Billy Kay and Peyton Royce storyline, because that would have been a great way to have Asuka lose the title, because she doesn't lose it, essentially.
Yeah, she doesn't lose it.
And then you get the whole quest for her getting it back type thing.
Yeah.
I think WWE dropped the ball a bit there, because I think Asuka's title run has become a little bit stale.
Yeah.
That would have rejuvenated it a little, or at least rejuvenated the division a little bit, and it would have given Peyton and Billy major heat.
Yes,
with
sure.
the fans, and it would have worked really well. But I don't write WWE. Mm-hmm. Maybe I should.
Maybe you should. Hashtag hire Sonny and Finn for creative. so yes, Asuka ended up on top. He kicked both Billy Kay and Peyton Royce to death, which I predicted. So that's a point to me. Ding. Finn 3, Sonny 2. There we go. Okay. Get my words out.
Just excited that we're actually getting to record this podcast this week.
Yeah.
We had a week off and now we're all giddy.
I'm trying to blast through it as quick as I can. Now we've got Bobby Roode versus Shinsuke Nakamura, the main event for the NXT Championship. And once again, it's great.
Superb.
Excellent match.
Really good match.
Yes, the two guys are the best entrances in WWE right now.
Best entrance music, best entrance.
Yeah, for sure.
Nakamura probably has one of the best WWE entrance themes ever.
Yes, I agree.
I think we should do one time a little discussion where we go through the best entrance themes.
Yeah, a top 10 Sonny and Finn entrance themes.
Yes.
Something like that, yeah. Yeah, well, maybe next week.
Yeah, maybe we'll do that next week. That could be topic of the show next week. Episode 51, about entrance themes.
Cool, be good. Okay. Excellent.
I'm already excited. Can't wait to compile my list. Plus, it also gives me an excuse to listen to entrance themes on Spotify.
Yeah. Number one is Val Venus. Hello, ladies.
Marie.
spoilers. good match. Shinsuke injured his knee during the match. He's played into the story. Bobby Roode blocked it off, busting crab. Shinsuke tried to counter into like a triangle choke, but couldn't. Bobby hit his DDT and won.
Yeah.
Which I predicted. That's 4 points to me, 2 to Sonny. So I get a point for the year.
Yay. Congratulations on the first points of the year go to you.
Yay, thank you.
I didn't see Roode winning at all.
I took the outside bet on that one. Because I honestly didn't expect it either. I just thought I'd say it's a bit different. But I'm pleased he did.
I am too, because, I mean, the momentum is firmly behind him at the minute. And he's got his entrance theme to thank for that.
Glorious.
A great deal.
For sure.
I don't know what happens to Shinsuke now.
Yeah.
Because he's lost that championship twice now. So it's okay being the first ever NXT champion two times. Two-time NXT champion, rather. But I don't know.
Yeah.
What now? I mean, usually when people lose it twice, they're off to the main roster. But according to what Triple H says, there's no plans to bring him up yet.
Yes.
But he's 37 years old. So, I mean, if he's going to make that jump, he's going to have to make it, you would think, fairly soon.
Yeah, sooner rather than later.
I don't think we'll get it the Raw after WrestleMania. We won't get it before WrestleMania.
No.
And I don't think we'll get it the Raw after WrestleMania, because I think Finn Balor will come back that night.
Oh, yeah, probably. That makes sense.
It would. Obviously, we'll talk about it nearer the time anyway. But, I don't know what happens to Shinsuke now, and it'd be interesting to see what happens next, because I think... Roode, I mean, I don't know what happens on NXT. I've avoided any spoilers, but watch that tomorrow. Be interested to see sort of what happens next. I know Cassius Ohno, or Chris Hero, depending on what you want to call him. Chris Hero is a much better name. Why can't they just use that?
I agree.
He's coming back, and he realistically should be a big player.
Yes.
So maybe him and Roode will have some sort of program, because they are playing off Nakamura's injury.
Yes. So, interesting.
We'll see.
Yeah.
It was a good show all around, though.
Great show.
Really, really good.
So I guess that brings us to the Royal Rumble.
Yep.
blast through it as always. So pre-show, Becky, Naomi, Nikki versus Alexa, Mickey and Natalia. Good guys won. We said the bad guys would win. No, neither get a point. Next match, tag team championship match. Cesaro and Sheamus versus Gallows and Anderson. Cesaro versus Gallows and Anderson.
Nice.
And, yeah. And we've got some new champions. Yeah, Gallows and Anderson won. Yay.
Why is this on the pre-show?
I don't know. It's dumb.
This is so stupid. It just shouldn't have been on the pre-show. It's
agreed.
Just... I don't know. It's frustrating because it makes the tag team titles look... Now, I get they want people to watch the pre-show. But, I mean, I think people do watch it anyway.
It's free everywhere, so...
usually, yeah, you can even watch it on YouTube.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't think title matches should be on the pre-show.
I agree, completely. So, yeah, I would like to see... I didn't see what's a pre-show, unfortunately. I didn't think they were going to win it on the pre-show. That's why I skipped it, but they did. And I'm glad they did.
Oh, yeah, I'm really glad they did.
But
did
should have been on the main show.
I hope this is a sign of things to come, and I hope it's the start of a long, healthy tag team title run for the two of them.
Yes.
Because they deserve it.
For sure.
They're easily... one of the best teams, if not the best team in WWE at the minute. So,
yep.
Well deserved. Should have been on the main show.
Yes, agreed. Then we had Sasha Banks versus Nia Jax.
This should have been on the pre-show.
Yeah.
My thinking behind this not being on the pre-show was they didn't want a second women's match on the pre-show.
I think it was
Women's Revolution. Oh, sorry. It was, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah,
oh, there was three matches on the pre-show. This didn't open the show. Sorry. Yeah, my bad.
Yep. And it was lasted like 2 minutes. And Nia Jax won in like 2 seconds.
Yeah.
So, great.
Did either of us get a point for the tag team titles, by the way?
No, we both said Cesaro and Sheamus would carry on.
That was our pre-show logic, by the way.
Yeah, it was, yeah. But screw us.
Because Nia Jax versus Sasha was always on the pre-show, wasn't it? But the six-woman tag team wasn't supposed to be on the pre-show.
Yeah, that was originally supposed to be on the main show for some reason.
Okay, that's where my confusion sets in. I apologise.
No problem. So you said Nia would win that, so you get a point for that. One Sunny. Ding.
What did you have... Sasha to win that?
I don't remember. I don't know. Just because she's babyface and she's landed a whole lot of momentum after losing to Charlotte. So maybe give her a bit of push, but no. Guess not.
This is all going to sort of go towards Nia being in a fatal four-way match at WrestleMania for the women's title.
Probably, yeah. Probably right. So then we had the first match of the main show, Bayley versus Charlotte Flair. And it was fine. It was decent. It was okay.
I thought it could have been better, I have to be honest.
Yeah,
I don't think it was that good. It's a little bit disappointing considering that you know these two women can put on a really, really excellent match.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was just okay. I mean, Charlotte won.
She did. One with a natural selection on the ring apron, which was weird.
Did you know that the ring apron is the hardest part of the ring?
It is?
Yeah, apparently so.
Why does no one ever say that?
I don't know. They should really point it out on TV more.
They should.
Yeah.
Damn.
They don't use that spot enough at the minute either, where they do a finisher on the apron.
Yeah, no one ever does that anymore. It's weird.
No, it's weird. It's really strange.
So you said Charlotte would win that, which you did. So you get a point for that. Well done.
I can't believe you went for Bayley.
I know.
Believe you went for Bayley.
That was a outside bet, and a mistake.
Fair enough.
So we had Kevin Owens versus Roman Reigns, and it was pretty good, actually.
It was good.
Yeah.
Jericho was suspended above the ring in a shark cage.
Chris in the cage match. Yes. By our toys.
Hashtag by our toys.
And it was a no DQ match, which I'm not sure they mentioned before the pay-per-view, but...
I don't think they did. Yeah. I mean, I was watching it with a friend and we questioned it.
Yeah,
because as soon as they announced it, we were like, okay, so why is Jericho in that cage now?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Basically, they shoehorned that stipulation in to help the finish.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And it also made some of the spots in the match pointless, because why does Jericho need to drop brass knuckles from the cage when Kevin Owens can just go under the ring and pull out any weapon he desires?
Exactly. Just carry his hand, brass knuckles on him anyway.
Yeah.
Just no DQ. Yeah. Weird. Obviously, Kevin Owens won due to outside interference from Braun Strowman. Speared him through a table or something.
Yeah.
Well, body slammed through a table.
Yeah.
So Kevin Owens won. Good. Which neither of us said. We both said Roman Reigns would win.
Yeah, we were so certain as well.
Yeah, seriously.
Have you heard us talk on episode 49 or whatever one it was?
Yeah.
We were so adamant. I had a whole plan for Roman Reigns going to WrestleMania. And none of that's happening now. So
yeah, there's like something even worse is happening. So good. Which we'll get into in a minute. So we had the Cruiserweight Championship match. Neville versus Rich Swann. And that was really good.
It was good, enjoyable.
Yes. Neville won with his new submission thingy. It's very cool looking. Very heelish. I like it.
Mm-hmm.
Neville's a great heel.
Thing is, if you're going to be a heel, you can't be flipping and flopping around all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just not a heelish thing to do.
Exactly. It's like even teased, I think, on this week's war. When he jumped at the outside and then got halfway, he's like, nah, screw you guys.
Yeah. That's it. Cool. But I think Neville's taken this heel role and just embraced it. And yeah. He's done really, really good things with it.
Exactly, yeah.
Him winning against Rich Swann was absolutely the correct decision. Simply because he's the king of the cruiserweights, self-proclaimed. And you can't be the king of the cruiserweights and not win the belt.
Yeah, exactly.
The belt has changed hands a few times now, which is a little bit disappointing and annoying. Yeah. But I think Neville will have it for a little while now.
I think so.
Until Austin Aries eventually takes it from him, which he will.
Yeah, probably. So yeah, great match. Both said Neville would win, so both get a point there.
Ding ding.
Ding ding. Then we had probably the match. Wait,
we both had Roman. Sorry, carry on. Ignore me.
Yeah, okay. So yeah, the match of the night, for sure, was John Cena versus AJ Styles for the WWE Championship.
Mm-hmm.
It was amazing.
It was absolutely incredible. 5-star match.
For sure. So many counters, so many finishes, kicks out. There's a super AA off the top. It's AJ kicked out of, which is crazy.
Which I couldn't believe he did, actually.
Yeah, same.
I thought, this is it for sure now. He's done.
Yep, me too. It was incredible. Great match. Yeah, Cena was just coming out with random moves. He did like a... what was it called? Oh, like a big ending type of move. Like a Big E's finisher.
Yeah.
Did like a code red. Just random stuff. Started inventing moves out of nowhere. it was very cool. Ended with a star dash into a forearm, counted into an AA, into another AA, and Cena won. 16-time champion. Tied to Ric Flair, nice.
I feel like, based on what appears to be the plans for WrestleMania, this Cena title reign is a little bit pointless, and they're basically rushing things to get the WrestleMania wheels in motion.
Seems that way.
He'll break that record now for sure.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But it was a fantastic match. I don't really have any problem with Cena winning.
No.
But based on what the plans are for AJ Styles for WrestleMania, I'm a little bit disappointed that he lost the belt. But in the grand scheme of things, with what the main event of WrestleMania is potentially going to be, and the storytelling that the full circle storytelling that's going to bring, I'm sort of okay with it.
Yeah.
I did beat around the bush with it there, but we will talk about it in more depth.
Yeah, for sure. So, once again, you caught that one, so you get another point. 74-1. So you've been
it's not looking good for you, is it?
It's not. You've been
responsible. Fast game over already because we've already got the Royal Rumble left.
Yeah, exactly. And the Royal Rumble match itself was a match that happened.
We don't have to run down every entrant here.
No, we won't.
Let's pick out some specific enjoyable parts of the Royal Rumble. There was very few. Ty Dillinger was at number 10.
Yes, that was very cool. Nice bit of fan service from WWE.
Yeah, because if it wasn't Ty Dillinger, they were all so excited for it. They were chanting 10 even before he even came down. And if it wasn't Ty Dillinger, if Epico would have come running down, I'm pretty certain that place would have been burnt down.
Oh my God, yeah. that was cool.
10! Welcome to Puerto Rico.
boo!
It would have been the worst. But it was awesome to see Ty Dillinger. There is a place for him on the main roster.
There is.
On SmackDown, of course, not Raw, because he'll just get completely lost on Raw. God.
Yes, make him IC champion or something.
But don't Apollo Crews him. Don't Tyler Breeze him.
Yes, please. Please don't. But yeah, that was cool. Should last a bit longer, in my opinion, but did eventually get eliminated by, I think, Braun Strowman. What else happened? Oh, I had a cool moment with the Wyatts. Luke Harper finally attacking Bray Wyatt.
Yeah,
went to go for a Sister Abigail on him, which I thought was cool. But then Randy Orton RKO'd him out of nowhere. so that's cool. Nice bit of dissension there. Luke Harper's looking to break out on his own, which is cool.
Yep.
What else happened?
Baron Corbin eliminated Braun Strowman.
That's very cool.
Which is very cool.
Big push for Thingamajig.
Baron Corbin.
Baron Corbin, that's it. Thank you.
Both of them guys are going to have big 2017s.
For sure, yes. Big things in their future. Excited.
Absolutely, yeah.
Happy fun. For sure. So then the three old men, Bork Laser, Oldberg, and old Undertaker Man, comes out like 26, 28, and 29.
That's ridiculous.
Yeah, the part-time is putting in a part-time shift, as you said last week.
I like Goldberg, and you have to respect Undertaker. I'm not a Brock fan.
Me neither.
But this is stupid. It's such a crap way of doing it.
Yeah.
But people already don't like the part-timers, and the fact that they do a part-time shift in the Royal Rumble is just ludicrous to me.
Yeah. Stupid. It's dumb. And then we had number 30. Who could it be? Who could be number 30? What surprise entrant could it be? Could it be Samoa Joe?
Well, it could be Kurt Angle.
Could be Kurt Angle. Could be
Finn Balor.
Finn Balor returning.
Maybe.
So then the countdown began. Hit number one. Hit zero.
Everyone's standing up in anticipation.
Yeah. And then da-da. Bloody Roman, bloody Reigns. Number 30. So I just burst out laughing when it happened. I was like, for God's sake.
You just can't believe it. He comes hobbling out. Now, whose spot has he taken? Because if he'd have won that belt, who would have been number 30?
Yeah.
Kevin Owens.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Maybe Samoa Joe. He's just like, nah, I'm going. Screw you, Samoa Joe.
Thing is, when you're looking back at it on reflection, because obviously Samoa Joe came in the night after.
Yeah.
It's pointless Samoa Joe coming in at the Royal Rumble because he's not going to win it. So the night after makes perfect sense. But at the time, it's just so funny.
Yes.
Because, we've just had this whole farce of Goldberg eliminating Brock and in record time and embarrassing him, and then Undertaker throwing people out, and then Roman comes in and he throws Undertaker out and they have a stare down.
Yeah.
It's just like the last part of the Royal Rumble match just felt so ridiculous.
Yeah.
And I already knew Randy Orton was going to win because the betting odds just didn't change ever.
Yeah, exactly.
He was favourite and we were all like, nah, that'll change.
Nah.
And then it never did. We were like, oh, okay, well, Randy Orton's going to win it. And the fact that he was there at the death, and he was like,
here we go. God, yeah.
The Royal Rumble we always get so excited for the Royal Rumble and then it always disappoints.
Pretty much. AJ Styles was caught last year. Being there, but yeah.
I mean, by the winners.
Randy
Orton winning, it could have been worse. That's all I can say. Could have been worse.
According to like backstage rumors, which I don't have to get into very often, but the reason they had Reigns given 30 was to like dull the disappointment when Randy eventually wins. It's because people will be like, oh, at least it isn't Roman. So he gets like a face pop, even though it's a heel.
To me, it makes no sense. Fact that WWE are thinking like that, should that actually be the case, is very worrying for Roman Reigns' future.
Seriously, yeah. Very strange.
Because they've either lost faith in him already.
Yeah.
They're going to have to do something to change. I mean, we aren't anti-Roman Reigns.
No, it's fine. It's just
funny that these things... It's Cena again.
It is. It's exactly what it is.
People don't like Roman Reigns already. So the fact that they had him come in at 30.
Yeah.
Just to ease the pain of Randy Orton winning is just not good.
It's not good at all. So Tony wins the best overall on that one, obviously. That's a point each so far in the year.
Yep.
Good start to first best of the year.
Yep.
Still a draw.
How are you getting on with Oli Oli 2, by the way?
I'm getting through it.
Have you hit a wall with it?
I'm playing it on and off. I'm getting through like a level or two like every time I play. Just 5-starring the levels in amateur or the amateur courses, whatever they are.
Yeah.
It's hard.
It is hard, yeah.
I would like to try and platinum it. Hopefully it'll happen before the end of the year, but I don't know.
We'll see.
We'll see how it goes. I'll keep plugging away at it.
Okay, cool.
So,
the Royal Rumble overall, it was two great title matches. The women's title match was disappointing. The Cruiserweight title match was good. The two main titles were great.
Yes.
And the Royal Rumble was the Royal Rumble match. We build our hopes up. We look forward to surprise entrants. They never come, apart from Ty Dillinger.
Apart from Ty. That was the thing.
My head went when Enzo Amore came out.
Oh, God, yeah, number 27. It's not for God's sake.
I didn't even think he was going to be in it.
No.
It's like they were making it up towards the end.
Yeah, pretty much.
These old guys are going to come in now. We need cannon fodder. Let's just throw Enzo in there. For him to get thrown out.
Yeah.
So yeah, the Raw Rumble was okay. So now we move on. We don't need to go. So what happened the night after on Raw? Samoa Joe came in and beat up Seth Rollins.
Yes.
Now Seth Rollins is injured. Sadness. WWE are clearly going to panic and try and do something else unless they can get Seth back in time.
Yes. Interesting one.
Let's go to this week. Let's not talk about everything that happened on Raw because there was a lot of garbage again.
Mm.
Let's talk about the build towards Fastlane onwards. And then we'll talk about Elimination Chamber this Sunday.
Cool. Okay. So we started off with a really cool, story package between Triple H and Seth. They're showing you like what's happened and the story between them. I thought it was very cool. Normally I'll skip that stuff to begin with, but I sat and I watched it because it was nice.
Yeah, it was good.
Good bit of storytelling. And yeah, Samoa Joe was there in a suit to sign his war contract.
Let's just give some props to Samoa Joe here.
Yes.
How excellent is he?
Like, very excellent.
He's just... when he was giving his promo, he was like, I will crush your heroes. And then when they wake up, I will crush them again. It's like, yes, Joe, yes. You're an amazing heel.
He's great.
I can't wait.
Yeah, it's so good. And yeah, when Mace came down, oh, I'm the biggest dog in here. Blah, 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 blah. And then I must later that night.
Yeah, I mean, the crowd are very pro Samoa Joe. You could tell that from the marks that were in the crowd. And you could hear the Joe chants and all that sort of stuff. This is going to do Roman no favours again.
Yep. This is like they're trying to bury poor Reigns.
Because
not intentionally.
Reigns
but...
gets booed out of the building every time. Joe is supposed to be a heel. So you got a face who is secretly a heel. Well, there's no secret about it, actually.
Basically a heel.
And then Joe, who's the heel. I just don't think that's very good booking.
It's not.
You have a super face against... Because Reigns is not a super face. Just forget it.
Yep.
Turn him heel, have him be massive heel character forever.
Yeah.
Because no one's ever going to like him.
Exactly.
Until they get bored of it and... I don't know. It just isn't happening.
Agreed.
Forget it. So put a super face against your new super heel.
Yes, I agree. That makes perfect sense. Which is why WWE will never do it.
Yep.
What else happened that night? We had Akira Tozawa debut in the cruiserweight division. He's great. He had a great match against
awesome.
Drew Gulak.
Yep. Really, really good. I'm impressed by him, and he got the crowd on side as well.
Yeah.
With his, ah!
A bit annoyed that they're making him speak Japanese. He can speak better than English. What are you doing? Why? I don't get it.
It's like that Kai and Tai thing where they used to have the dubbed over the top of Takamichinoku and Funaki.
Indeed.
So it is a bit weird. Eventually, I think he will just sort of...
Yeah, I think it's going to be one of these things where it's like, he speaks Japanese in promos, and then just some guy speaks up to him in English. He's like, oh, hey, yeah. I speak both English.
And Vince will just be crying with laughter.
Exactly, yeah. So, yeah.
He speaks English. Fooled you. You're fooling anyone. Old idiot.
The old idiot.
It's also the same, though. They could have given him better entrance music. It's crap.
It's a bit crap, yeah.
It's like a Tyler Bates entrance music. I don't like that either.
Oh, yeah. Strange. Yeah. But it's called German Suplex. Nice, quick German Suplex.
Yeah, I love the snap German Suplex. It's awesome.
Very cool. Then we had Jericho and Owens in the ring once again, speaking about wanting to be main event at WrestleMania, to be Jericho versus Owens, best friends for the championships.
Which would be awesome, by the way.
It would be. But then good old Oldman comes down to Goldman. I should say. And challenges... Yeah, Oldberg. Oldman Goldberg.
He's jacked up, though. He's fucking jacked.
He's huge. And yeah, challenges Kevin Owens to a match at Fastlane, which Jericho accepts on his behalf. Cheers, Jericho.
Okay.
And,
so...
Which is going to win, obviously.
Yes, he's going
to win. Yeah.
Alright, so the plan is Goldberg is going to beat Kevin Owens for that Universal Championship. And he's going to take it into WrestleMania and defend it against Brock. Because at the same time, He accepted Brock's challenge for one final match at WrestleMania. So, my thinking behind this is, we are going to get Jericho versus Kevin Owens, but it'll be for the United States Championship.
Yeah.
Kevin Owens will win that. Jericho will disappear for a little while.
Yeah.
Goldberg versus Brock is a match that people aren't that interested in. They like chanting Goldberg. They like seeing Brock. But the idea of them fighting each other isn't one that really... gets people's engines running, including myself.
Yeah, same.
So, my thinking here is that WWE feel that if they have the championship on the line, that people will care about it more.
They won't.
This is going to close the show, I think, as well.
Well, disappointing end. You'll know that be.
Only won't be long.
Yeah, I feel bad for Owens. It's going to be like a 2-minute match, isn't it? It's going to get crushed.
Oh yeah, and the internet will melt.
Yep.
When Goldberg wins that belt in 2 minutes, which he will, unless there's, because they can't possibly have Owens look stronger than Brock.
No,
I'm sorry, the WWE just won't have it. They love Brock so much that they can't have, they just won't have Kevin Owens look stronger than Brock. No way.
No way.
Unless there's some sort of cheating going on and some distractions from Jericho, from the outside or whatever. But I don't see this match lasting very long. So Goldberg's going to win the Universal Championship in record time.
Yep. And it's going to be weird.
Now, I don't have a problem with Kevin Owens losing the championship.
No.
I don't have a problem with Goldberg being the champion and having his last stint on top. Because since he's been back, he's not let himself go. He's in great shape. His promo work needs work.
He's top head and lockers on the way to
ring. But his in-ring work hasn't changed because that's what he did. He speared, he jackhammered, he snarled, and he bled for no reason at all. And then and then he left. And that's Goldberg's career in a nutshell.
Pretty much.
So I don't have a problem with Goldberg winning the belt. What I do have a problem with is Brock winning the belt at WrestleMania.
Yeah, and then having it and not being on TV for months.
Exactly. So this is the problem here. Your main championship, which needs to be on TV because it's not very prestigious at the minute.
Yep.
Kevin Owens has had a very bad run with it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I'm not sad to see his run end.
Yeah, not Kevin Owens' fault, by the way.
No, not Kevin Owens' fault at all. But having Brock win the championship just doesn't make any sense to me. Now, So WWE want Goldberg versus Brock to mean something.
Mm-hmm.
And putting the championship on it, whatever.
Yeah.
But Brock isn't going to be on TV all the time. Now, unless Brock loses it the night after on Raw to a returning Finn Balor.
Yep. Which would be amazing.
It would be amazing, but do you see it happening?
I do think it'll be Finn Balor to win it off, whoever wins, Brock, obviously. But then if it'll be the night after, who knows? Probably the next pay-per-view, whatever that would be. Next World Series pay-per-view.
It would be very cheap on the Universal Championship if Brock dropped it the night after.
It would be,
because
that's
two title changes in the space of 24 hours.
Yes. It'll be cool just to see Finn Balor back fighting Brock
Lesnar. Oh, man, the crowd would go ballistic as well. The crowd would love it.
It'd be cool. But yeah, you're right. It makes the Universal title look less prestigious than it already is. It's already pretty not prestigious.
But also, Goldberg would be due a rematch.
Oh, God, yeah. Oh, God. weird one. Unless it's Goldberg that disappears into nowhere, which would be nice.
Which I think will happen.
Probably.
I think I'll just ignore the rematch.
Yeah.
And then someone else will challenge for it. But I don't like the idea of Brock. I don't like the idea of a part-timer having the championship. I know I've just said I don't mind Goldberg having it, but it's to build toward excitement towards a match for WrestleMania.
Yeah.
But beyond that, and starting the new season of WWE, I don't think a part-timer having the championship is the way to go.
I agree.
You need a full-timer who's going to be on Raw week in, week out to have that belt.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody who's going to hold it for a decent amount of time, because Brock won't.
Yep. I agree.
Rant over.
Yeah. Good rant. After this... Little promo. Goldberg went to the back and took his shirt off and gave it to a fan, which is weird.
He's all about the fans, though, his old Big Bill.
Yeah, I thought it was weird because it wasn't like a wrestling shirt. It was just his normal shirt.
No, it was a Goldberg shirt, wasn't it?
Was it? Oh, okay. I wasn't paying attention.
Yeah, it must have been covered in sweat and water and probably blood or something, hasn't it? It's bleeding from the nipples. You just can't see because Goldberg's always bleeding.
Yeah. It's a little bit weird. Imagine if it's like going down the street and someone takes off his shirt and handing it to you. There you go. I'm famous. Bye.
You'll be doing that one day.
Yeah, that'd be me.
Finn! Oh, yeah.
There you go. Yeah, yeah. Don't worry, I'm famous. I've got a podcast and everything.
Yeah. One day, Finn.
One day.
He's going to be walking down the street with, like, literally just pants on because you've given all your clothes away.
Yeah.
You can't have these. I'm so sorry.
So what happens next? So Cesaro is famous and Gallus and Anthony had a rematch. Good to see Gallus and Anthony with the belts. Cool match. Enzo and Castro at ringside. Ended by DQ after Big Gas kicks Gallows, I think, because he attacks Enzo, I think.
Sure.
Something like that. I don't know. It was dumb. Good match up until then, though.
You don't think they're going to put the belts on Enzo and Castillo at some point? That's not the way to go either, I don't think.
No, not ever, really. I'm going to say not yet, but I don't think they should have it. Because it's just, they're like a comedy act.
They are, yeah.
It's like, I know New Day were a comedy act, sort of, but they're a good wrestler as well. They can back it up.
I like Big Cass, and I like Enzo as a personality, but
yeah, I don't know. It's not believable for them to be champions, I don't think.
No, I always thought that when when Enzo was sort of fighting singles matches in NXT, and he was fighting much bigger guys, and
yeah.
I just thought he doesn't look like a wrestler. His in ring work isn't that good.
Yeah,
sure, he's funny on the mic, and the promos are stellar every week, but. Yeah. I think he's more of a manager than an actual in-ring competitor.
Yeah, I don't agree, I think.
You could put him in the Mr. Fuji, Bobby the Brain Heenan type. I mean, yeah. Not as prestigious as those two.
Maybe not.
Of course, no, at least not yet. I mean, of course, down the line, he could become one of those sorts of things. But
who knows?
I don't know.
So, yeah, that was the thing. That's going to be a feud coming up. Probably a fatal a triple threat tag team match for the titles or something on Fatal Fast Lane. Who knows?
Sure.
Then we had New Day doing a thing about ice cream. Something ice cream.
I always skip the New Day stuff now because it doesn't mean anything to me.
That match against the Shining Stars. And Shining Stars looks pretty decent in it, actually.
Yeah, it looked like they had a good match, to be honest, but yeah. In fast forward, at least.
Yeah. New Day won, obviously, because that's what they do.
Of course.
Then we had Sami Zayn versus Chris Jericho for the US title, which was excellent.
Mm-hmm.
Two great wrestlers having a great match.
It's weird when that happens. I know we said this the other week. It was weird when Sami and Seth had just one absolutely incredible match on Raw.
I know.
It's just weird when two good wrestlers are put in the ring together and they have a good match. I mean, I didn't think that would happen.
I know. Amazing.
It's weird. I'd like to see it more often, but
me too.
I'm not holding my breath.
So yeah, the match ended when Sami got kicked by Kevin Owens from the outside while the ref was distracted and then turned around into a codebreaker and Jericho retained. Good match.
Good cool stuff.
Ending. Then we had Austin Aries interviewing Neville.
Austin Aries had music, by the way, this week.
He did. Cool.
The return is close, I think.
It's close. I think so. He's ready. But they announced a failed 5-way elimination number one contender match on 205 Live. I haven't seen it.
I haven't seen it either.
Really? And then they had a brawl ensued and then a tag team match made during the break.
And, that is classic Raw.
Of course.
Yeah. Oh, of course. Welcome back. Commissioner, General Manager Mick Foley made this match during the commercial.
Yeah. Of course he did. Skip.
But because it's the cruises, I watch it because I care.
Yeah, me too. Also during that, Emelina apparently is debuting next week.
Of course.
We heard that before. So we'll see.
I still don't think she's coming back as Emelina.
Yeah, it's going to be a huge troll, I think, isn't it?
I think it is. It's like when they were bigging up Titus. What the hell's he called? The Funkasaurus. What the hell's his real name?
I don't know. Funk is on a roll.
It's called Tyrus in TNA.
Yeah. What is he called? What was he called?
Brodus Clay.
Brodus Clay, there you go.
So when they were hyping the return of the monster Brodus Clay, and I was really excited for it.
Yeah.
And then the bloody disco music starts and he comes dancing down to the ring. I'm like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah.
Thanks for ruining it.
Then he had Tensai, aka Albert, joined as well.
Yeah, look, see, that's a disappointment as well, yeah, Tensai, because that had the potential to be great because
it did.
He was doing great things in Japan.
He was. And,
But no, they just find a way to balls things up and it happens more often than not.
Yeah, it's a shame.
With this Emelina thing, it isn't very PG.
It's not.
Because, you know, there's kids watching with their parents and, you know, we know that the kids are, you know, in loving the Emelina stuff, but and so are the dads.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's not very PG.
It's not.
And we've not had much of bikini exposure since the Women's Revolution and
exactly.
The PG stuff kicked in. So what I think is going to happen here is they're going to tease it and Emma's going to come out and beat the shit out of everybody and be a serious competitor.
Yes, that'd be cool. I like that a lot, actually.
I'd prefer it.
Yeah, same.
Don't get me wrong. I mean, I still follow her on Instagram.
Yeah, of course.
But I don't want to see it. It's weird because I've gotten to this point now where I'm not bothered about seeing that. I'd rather see her come back and be an actual wrestler.
Yeah. Like, women's wrestling is...
Because what is she going to do every week?
Place. Yeah.
What is she going to do as Emelina every week?
Exactly, yeah. Who knows?
I think she'll come back as a bad guy. I mean, that's the way to go.
Yeah.
You troll the crowd so badly that she comes back and just is a complete monster.
Yeah.
And just starts being the good wrestler that she is and getting the recognition she deserves. She doesn't need to flaunt around in a bikini for that.
Agreed. Looking forward to it.
We're not gay, honestly, we're not.
We're not gay. That's the title this week.
We might get some heat for that.
Maybe. Maybe not then.
Not that there's anything wrong with it.
No, of course not.
Let's just say that for...
full disclaimer, nothing wrong with it.
Defending ourselves.
Yeah. Cruiserweight tag team match, good. Never refused to tag with Noam Dar.
Again.
Yeah, yes. Good heel work. Good match. Good. good.
Good.
So, they had the main event, which was, of course, Samoa Joe versus Roman Reigns, or Hawaiian Pete, as we like to call him.
Hawaiian Pete versus Roman Reigns.
Yes.
The Samoan showdown.
Yes, exactly.
I suppose that line wasn't used.
Yeah, me too. Maybe if Mauro was on the commentary, he would have done.
Yeah, sure.
And it was okay. Joe attacked before the match started.
Of course, because he's the heel.
Of course.
Although the crowd secretly were loving it.
Yeah, of course. Roman Reigns got the upper hand, as he does. But then, once again, as he does every week, Braun Strowman interfered in the main event. And then Samoa Joe won with the Uranagi, is it called?
Uranagi.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean the rock bottom where he doesn't go down?
Exactly, yeah.
The Bray Wyatt signature move.
Oh, yeah, of course. No muscle buster. Boo.
That's not surprising to me.
Yeah.
It's a shame because, I don't think it's that risky of a move.
No. He did injure poor Tyson Kidd, but...
Did he do it out of the corner, didn't he?
I think so.
The Uranagi?
I don't know.
Because usually when... Because he's done the Uranagi suplex for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
Because obviously they usually run towards him and he does the Uranagi out of the corner.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm not sure he did.
Come on, I think it was just turning away. I think he dealt with Braun Strowman, turned around and Samoa just kind of hit him with it.
I mean, I've seen people moaning online that Samoa Joe won because Braun Strowman and it makes him look cheap. I don't believe that to be the case.
No, I think it's fine.
He's winning in a heel way and they're trying to get him over as a heel and he's new to Raw.
Yeah.
And what you have to remember here is that some of these people don't watch NXT. I mean, we say that a lot, but yeah, it's true.
It's true.
I mean, you have people like Finn and I that do watch NXT and do know who Samoa Joe is.
Mm-hmm.
But there are people in the crowd, kids, they've not seen him in TNA. They obviously don't watch ROH or anything like that.
Yeah.
These are the same people that don't know who AJ Styles is until he comes to WWE.
Exactly, yeah.
So, yeah, Samoa Joe's going to have to win a few matches like this to get him over as a heel, and I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
And I think people on the internet are too quick to jump on this. Oh, God, they're ruining Samoa Joe already. It's like, he's been there a week, and he's been the focal point of both shows.
Yep.
He was the main angle on his debut, when he beat Rollins up.
Yep.
He was the opening segment and the main event of week two.
Yeah.
Tell me how that's ruining Samoa Joe. It's the logic of the internet,
yeah,
of the internet wrestling community, which, by the way, I hate that term.
Yeah.
People just need to look at it with a wider mind.
Yes, we're all wrestling fans at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Just wrestling fans.
You have to look at it with a bit more logic. Samoa Joe's not going to come in and just steamroll through Roman Reigns.
Yeah, exactly. It makes no sense. And it's fine. I'm fine with it.
Yeah, because it looks like they're building towards Roman Reigns versus Braun Strowman at Fastlane.
Yep.
So they have to advance that story as well because they didn't really... Braun Strowman fought four guys on Raw.
Oh, he did, yeah.
So they have to advance that Roman Reigns storyline somehow. And if he's in a match, well, it makes perfect sense.
Yep.
So it is what it is. Get over it, guys. Sorry.
Yep. It's fine. It's cool. So Braun obviously attacked after the match, hit Reigns with the steel stairs and then slammed him through the barricade. Ouch. And good.
Good.
Good stuff. More looking strong. And
And Joe looking strong too.
Yeah, everyone looks strong.
I'm delighted to see Joe on the main roster.
Me too. Excellent.
Deserves it.
Absolutely. So that was Raw. So we're going to do SmackDown, which is building up for the Elimination Chamber this weekend.
Which is, I still can't believe it. I know I've already said it on this podcast, but I can't believe that pay-per-view is this Sunday.
I know, so quickly.
It's like Raw Rumble was last weekend.
Yeah.
And now we've had a week of wrestling.
And
now we've had two episodes of SmackDown, like quickly build for this pay-per-view, quickly build.
Yeah.
Cena's the champion. Great, let's go.
Yeah, let's go. Whatever.
This can't be AJ Styles rematch in the Elimination Chamber. It can't be.
No, I think they said on Talking Smack that he will get another rematch. A proper rematch at some point.
Fucking right, he will.
Probably on SmackDown. Okay. So it started off with everyone coming into the ring saying, I'm going to win the Elimination Chamber. No, I'm going to win the Elimination Chamber.
Yeah,
as it always does.
So who we got? AJ?
Yep. AJ, Ambrose, Baron Corbin, The Miz, John Cena, and Bray Wyatt.
The Miz. Okay.
Yeah. There's a lot of good names in there, I think. Could be a good match.
I'm looking forward to it. I love the Elimination Chamber. And I'm actually excited for us to play it on 2K17 because we've never had to because we did last year because they didn't have the Elimination Chamber.
Yeah. They said it only happens once a year. He said, but yet last year, which didn't happen at all.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yes, that sets up a fatal four-way later for SmackDown, which is going to be The Miz, Baron Corbin, Dean Ambrose, The Miz, and AJ Styles. That was right then, not the main event, sorry.
Okay.
And it was good. Lots of multi-round spots, which I like. I like fatal four ways that aren't just, you know, two men fighting at a time, and then one guy goes out, and then there's two guys again.
Yep.
So yeah, lots of White Man stuff. Cool ending. Baron Corbin winning with the End of Days, pinning AJ Styles. Big win. Another big win for Baron. Good stuff. And yeah.
And cool. I'm sure that the internet wrestling fans will be like, oh God.
Oh, Baron Corbin is getting squashed by Baron. Blah, blah, blah.
AJ Styles has just come off one of the best WWE debut years ever. AJ Styles is at a point in his career where he doesn't need to win every week. He can't win every week.
Exactly.
It's like when you follow your favorite sports team. Like, you know, Man United can't win every week. It just doesn't happen.
Yeah.
Your favorites can't win every week. I'm sorry, guys. And it's the harsh reality.
Yeah.
But they're building a character in Baron Corbin, who is going to have a great year.
Yes.
So why not start that year by having him pin the former world heavyweight champion?
Exactly. It's cool. It's good building. I like it.
I like that we're at a point in our lives where we can accept and think about wrestling. I think because we do this, we do more often. If we didn't do this podcast, we'd be with the rest of them.
Probably. But I like Baron Corbin. He's
me too.
A lot of potential.
I didn't, and I thought when he came up to the main roster, it was too soon. But they've gotten around it very nicely.
Yeah, they built him
done a very, very really good job with him.
Yeah, good stuff. So between segments, we had a cool promo by Luke Harper challenging Randy Orton for the Elimination Chamber pay-per-view, and I thought he came across very well. Mm. Very eloquent and good.
He is good. Stuff.
Yeah. I like Luke Harper. He's got big things in his future, I think.
Yeah.
Good stuff. Don't have a match.
But we've always thought that.
Yeah, well, for sure. When he had the IC title briefly, he was excellent. An excellent match against Orton.
I still think Rowan's done for.
Rowan, yeah. I think so too.
Because, this whole thing looks like it's going to break the Wyatts up for good, and Bray's going to do his own thing.
Yeah.
Randy Orton will carry on being Randy Orton as he was before he joined the Wyatts. and Luke Harper will be excellent on his own.
Yeah.
And that leaves Roman in a place where it's like, okay, well, what do we do with this guy? Because he's not over with the crowd.
Yeah.
He's got a strange look. People just don't care.
Yeah, his moveset isn't amazing. He's got a cool spinning kick, but that's about it.
Yeah. Whereas Harper is so diverse. Like, he's a big guy and he's doing a Hurricane Runner, and he mixes the quick with the power moves, and it's like, okay, I can really get behind this guy.
Yeah.
And he's just awesome.
He is.
I think Rowan might be on the release list. I know I've said it before, but I do think he will be.
Yeah, it's a shame, but I agree.
Yeah.
So we had next match was Apollo Crews versus Dolph Ziggler. Very short. Apollo won with like a roll up within minutes, and then Dolph attacked him after the match with a chair, and then Kalisto came down and he got beaten up by a chair, and Dolph got the upper hand basically at the end of that. Falling in that feud, I guess. Shrug, who cares?
I'm going to have... I think they've made a handicap match for Elimination Chamber with Apollo and Kalisto against Dolph Ziggler.
Yes, interesting one.
Now...
Pre-show match, for sure.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah.
But, unless they have some story plans for this...
Maybe.
At this point, me and my friend were talking about this over text earlier on. Do you think they should turn Apollo heel?
I don't know.
They could never win.
They could. There's literally no momentum on the side at the minute.
Nothing.
The crowd barely reacts to him as well. It's a shame.
It is a shame. He'll have to change his moveset as well, like Neville has adapted.
Yeah.
But Apollo Crews would have to do the same thing. You know, could they just turn on Kalisto and beat the living crap out of him, and then the two of them are, you know, start some sort of weird heel underappreciated sort of faction thing?
Maybe. That could be cool, actually.
Yeah, it'd be awesome.
Hmm.
I mean, it's something to think about for sure, whether it happens or not. I just think they need to do something with Apollo Crews to get people on side very quickly, because it just isn't working for him.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a shame because he comes across as a really nice person,
yeah,
like just from watching Breaking Ground and stuff like that. But
I feel like they've dumbed him down a lot in WWE, because before in the indies, he'd done all this crazy flippy stuff, and now he's in WWE, he doesn't do a whole lot.
There's a couple of flips, like just the back flip into the splash and all that sort of thing. And okay, it's fine. As a heel, you wouldn't be able to do that. And they could really focus on his power side of things. He could be the muscle, Ziggler could be the mouthpiece. And it could work very well as a tandem.
Hmm. Yeah, it's not that you mention it. It does seem a bit weird that it's a 2-on-1 handicap match. So you think something's got to happen there. So,
yeah.
Interesting. Interesting thought. I like it.
But again, because we've made this, we've sort of thought this is going to be a really good idea. It's not going to happen.
No, of course not.
So it'd be awesome if you did. And I just think something has to happen here, because otherwise it's a pointless nothing match.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Imagine if they win clean.
Yeah.
Apollo and Kalisto. So what is this?
Well, that was pointless.
Yeah. But if they make something out of it, then I'm on board.
Yes, me too. Let me add the first double contract signing. Was Mickie James versus Becky Lynch and Alexa Bliss versus Naomi. And yeah, words fight.
Standard WWE contract signing behavior.
Exactly, yeah. Okay. Exactly what it was. There was a big tag team match. Pretty much every tag team on SmackDown in a match. Because at Elimination Chamber, it's going to be a tag team turmoil match.
Okay.
One team starts and then, or two teams start, and then once one gets eliminated, another one comes in.
Like the gauntlet.
Yeah, exactly, the gauntlet.
It's a gauntlet, but WWE have made its own name.
Exactly.
Tag Team Turmoil.
Exactly.
So, what I find this interesting over the last few weeks on SmackDown, actually, is they are trying to get these teams, I don't know if they're trying to get them over, but they're trying to shoehorn them all in. Like, we've seen the Vaudevillains, we've seen the Breezango, the Ascension. The Ascension are getting a lot more TV time.
The Ascension actually won this match as well.
Well, this is the thing, you see. Do we think finally they're going to... I mean, I don't want American Alpha. I don't think they should have maybe won it yet anyway.
Yeah.
But they had to take the belts off the Wyatts. I get it.
Yeah, that's fine.
I mean, could the Ascension be getting their time? I mean, they're extremely talented.
Yeah, for sure. I hope so. I mean, they deserve it.
But again, it's that thing taking the titles away from a new champion straight away without them really defending it and doing much with it. But that seems to be the WWE way at the minute.
Yeah.
The only champion you had The Miz and AJ Styles. Who have had respectable title runs.
Yeah. But yeah, I'd say other than that.
The tag team titles have been bounced around a bit. The Cruiserweight title has been bounced around a bit. US titles. Okay.
Yeah, I still know what you mean. But yeah, I think the tag team division on SmackDown isn't the strongest at the minute. So it needs building a bit. Because you've got...
But it could
American
be.
American Alpha's pretty much the only big team on there at the minute.
Who's that?
Pretty much the American Alpha. And then you've got Breezango, which is kind of like a gimmicky team. They got Heath Slater and Rhino, which is kind of... Vaudevillains, which are good, but have been kind of buried the last few weeks and not been seen a whole lot. Same with the Ascension and... who else? Yeah, that's it, isn't it?
Breezango, you seen?
Yeah, except Breezango. But,
Usos?
Oh yeah, Usos, who's changed gimmick, but again, just kind of been put in the background and not really seen a whole lot of.
Yeah, it's a shame that, because I felt that it was working.
Yeah, I did. I thought it was good.
They had that really good. So they sort of, I don't know, they were on TV, featured prominently every week.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know what happened there.
Yeah, weird one.
The SmackDown Tag Team Division is a weird one. It didn't help that they had the Wyatts win those tag team titles either.
Yeah.
From Heath Slater and Rhino.
Strange.
Were they in there as well, Heath Slater and Rhino?
Yeah, they were there.
Yeah. Weird one, but out of all of those, I'd like to see the Ascension mix it up. But at the same time, I would like the American Alpha to have a strong run with the belts.
Me too. Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen? Hopefully it will help build all the tag teams. I'm hoping for them from this next tag team turmoil match. I'll hopefully give everyone a good amount of time, show them what they can do, hopefully get more people on board with the tag team division, because right now it's a bit lackluster.
Yeah, and they also need to what I fully expect to happen in this turmoil match is for Breezango to get pinned really quickly. But I think that they should maybe avoid that and try and build them as a team, because individually they're great.
Yeah, yeah.
And as a comedy act tag team, which WWE always seems to want,
this
could really work. But they've just been given garbage to run with, and it's not good.
Yeah, I agree. Give them something. So after that, we had the main event. We had John Cena versus Randy Orton, number 317.
At least we're not getting it at WrestleMania.
Yeah, I was just about to say the same thing. At least it's pretty much confirmed it's not going to be a WrestleMania main event. Phew.
Well, yeah, that's it now. I mean, this isn't going to be the WrestleMania main event, because otherwise, why'd you give it away for free on SmackDown?
Exactly. It was a good match as well. It's always a good match. We just kind of bored of it now.
It hasn't happened for a while, so we can sort of...
It's first time with Randy's new Bray Wyatt weird gimmick thing.
Yeah.
So there's that. They both kick out each other's finisher. The referee gets knocked down. Bray Wyatt interferes. And then Luke Harper comes down to help. Attacks Bray Wyatt. and then Lolotina wins. Pretty much. But yeah, cool to see Luke Harper coming down and fighting Bray Wyatt again. And yeah, it was fine. It was a good match.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I mean, this is sort of Vince being like, oh, we're not going to get it at WrestleMania. Please let me have it on SmackDown. Please, please. One little thing. He just loves John Cena versus Randy Orton.
He does. It's his favorite.
He plays WWE 2K15 just so he can do the showcase mode with them.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he does it all the time. He just loves it. So, that was SmackDown. So let's give our predictions for the Elimination Chamber pay-per-view, which is unbelievably this Sunday.
Okay. I need to make a table. Bear with me. Just the thing here. Okay. So what order do we have it in here? So I've very hastily brought up the...
What are you doing? You're reading it off WWE.com?
Yes. Okay. It's in a weird order. I think it matches. Okay, got the main event first. I'll read it backwards. Back to front. So first we've got the 2-on-1 handicap match. Apollo Crews and Kalisto versus Dolph Ziggler.
I'm going to say Dolph Ziggler.
Okay.
Because something's going to happen.
Yes, I agree. Something has to happen. Otherwise it'd be just weird.
Well, it's just strange booking otherwise, isn't it? It just seems to be a very pointless waste of a match.
Exactly.
Imagine if Dolph Ziggler annihilates them both. Or the other way around. It's just either way, it's not believable.
Yeah.
So something has to happen in that match to make it have a point.
Yeah, I agree. I'm going to say Dolph Ziggler as well. Just because, as you say, Kalisto and Cruz winning would be super weird and bizarre.
Ziggler winning on his own would be super weird as well.
Yeah. But Dolph's going to win. For sure.
For sure. This change of character is not for nothing.
Exactly. what next? Sorry, bear with me. Oh, then we have Becky Lynch versus Mickie James. Interesting one.
Yes, it is an interesting one. I'm going to go for Mickie.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to go for Mickie. I don't know why. I'm okay with these feuds that are going on at the minute. I'm more interested in the women's championship because I think Alexa's doing a fantastic job.
Yes.
I'm fine with Mickie being there, and I appreciate that they've got to give Becky something to do as the former champion and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to say Mickie.
Yep, I agree. I think Mickie needs a win. She's recently returned after a long time. She needs something to make her, you know, still...
Relevant.
Relevant, yeah. Yeah, just so that she can still, you know...
But yeah, there's no point in bringing her back just for her to lose every sort of big hurdle.
Exactly, yeah. She needs to win.
It just seems very pointless.
Yeah, I agree. That brings us to the women's championship match. No, it doesn't. It means to other women's match. Nikki Bella versus Natalia. Three women's matches, interesting. Nikki Bella versus Natalia. It's been building a few that's... Jesus Christ, I can't speak.
A few that's been building for a few weeks.
That's what I was trying to say. Thank you.
To be honest, I don't care for this at all.
Jesus.
There's been a lot of brawls between the two of them over the last few weeks. Been some name calling and some scratching and hair pulling and pinching and other stuff.
Yep.
Natalia could do with a win.
Yeah.
But lol, Nikki wins.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to say the same thing. Nikki's going to win because she's the good guy. And good guys always win. And this feud doesn't really have any much legs after this. I can't imagine
it going
any longer.
It can't. Yeah. It can't go on after this. This needs to be the end of it. It's gone on too long anyway. They should have had it at the Royal Rumble.
Agreed.
Because SmackDown had one match at the Royal Rumble, which was the championship match.
That's true, yeah.
So they could have shoehorned... Although, I mean... Well, this has got three women's matches, so that would have meant Royal... You could have basically not had that six women tag team match.
Yeah, pretty much. And just,
they just seem to shoehorn the SmackDown women into the Royal Rumble just for the sake of it when they could have actually got rid of this Nikki versus Natalia feud there and then.
Yeah.
But yeah, I see Nikki winning. I don't. To be honest, I don't care about that feud at all.
Yeah, I'm struggling to care. So that brings us to the tag team championship match, tag team turmoil match. I've got American Alpha, the Usos, the Ascension, Heath Slater and Rhino, Breezango and the Ward Villains. Who's going to win?
I think American Alpha wins.
Okay.
It'd be good exposure for them to win on a pay-per-view.
Yeah.
Because they won the tag team titles on SmackDown and they've not really done much of anything since they won it. They weren't at the Royal Rumble. Neither of them were in the Royal Rumble. I think American Alpha do win here.
Yeah, again, I agree. I know it's been tag team titles and wars been jumping around a lot, but I can't see it happening on SmackDown. Just because they've only just won it and the new tag team and all that stuff.
SmackDown have a far more sensible tag team division if you look at it from a tag team perspective.
Yeah.
Like on Raw, you've got teams who have been put together like Cesaro and Sheamus going for it, and you know, Enzo and Cass, who to me don't really seem like serious contenders.
Yeah, same.
But with SmackDown, you've got established teams. So you've got the Vaudevillains, you've got the Ascension, the Usos. So, I mean, the only you know, exception there is Rhino and Heath Slater.
Yeah, yeah.
You could argue a case for Breezango, but at least they've got a name and a gimmick.
Yeah.
Which Heath Slater and Rhino don't really have. So I think American Alpha maybe have to win here to establish some sort of dominance in the tag team division. Because if they bounce that title around, it's just stupid.
Yeah, I agree. I think they're going to win that somehow. I think they start the match and then everyone else comes in. You've got to beat all five teams.
They start the match today. It's not like random.
Think so? Needs confirmation.
I can't remember how these things work.
Yeah, same.
WWE probably don't know how they work either. Just make it up.
Just make it up to go along.
Yeah.
Right, so that brings us to Luke Harper versus Randy Orton.
It's
going to be a good match, actually. Looking forward to this one.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that one too, actually. Who wins? I mean, logic points towards Randy Orton because he won the Royal Rumble and he's going to be fighting for the championship at WrestleMania.
True.
Can you really have him lose on the pay-per-view? The other thing is, does the match not end?
Maybe it's end of DQ.
No one wins.
Maybe.
I'm going to go for that, to be honest.
Nobody? Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to go nobody wins. Double disqualification. Or Luke Harper wins by count out DQ, some stupid way.
Okay.
I'm going to go for nobody wins.
You're going for nobody. Okay. I'm going to go for Luke Harper in some sort of shock, upset
okay.
victory. Yeah, maybe inadvertent, maybe Bray Wyatt distracts him inadvertently, distracts like Randy inadvertently or something.
Mm.
And then Luke Harper balls him up, something like that. And then that's like the tension between Randy and Bray setting up future stuff.
It's certainly an interesting one.
Yeah. Cool. Can look forward to that one. For sure.
Yeah.
Then we've got Alexa Bliss versus Naomi for the SmackDown Women's Championship.
Alexa Bliss.
Yeah.
She's having too much of a good run for them to take the belt off her just yet.
Yeah, she's great. Super over as well.
Crowd unbelievable, yeah.
Yeah.
She's just... We laud Alexa Bliss a lot, but for good reason. She's just done an incredible job since she came up from NXT.
Yeah.
Much better than I think anyone ever anticipated that she would.
Yeah, seriously.
And I'm super happy for her that she's making that championship her own.
Yeah.
She's given, you know, she's invented a new pose with the championship that you know, looks very cool.
Yeah, very cool.
Yeah, I'm super happy for her. It's awesome.
Me too.
So Naomi's time will come. I'm certain of that.
Oh yeah.
And I think it's overdue potentially.
Probably.
But you can't take it from Alexa, not yet.
No, I agree. I want to take Alexa as well. Just for the exact reasons. Yeah. She's great.
This pay per view's been thrown together massively.
Yeah, pretty much.
There's not a lot of thought gone in behind it.
Yeah. Oh dear.
I mean, some would argue the build was starting even before the Royal Rumble with Naomi, Alexa, Nikki, Natalia.
True.
The dissension between Bray Wyatt and Luke Harper and all this sort of stuff, but that, you know, it's not, Elimination Chamber hasn't been talked about until last week on SmackDown.
True.
So this is a big time thrown together pay per view.
Yes, I agree. So we just do our main events. The
Bray Wyatt.
Okay. Let's do it about yourself. You can say Bray Wyatt. It doesn't make a lot of sense, doesn't it?
Well, I mean I just think it's nailed on.
Yeah.
100 and. I'm so certain it's nailed on.
I mean,
it's been rumoured. You know, Meltzer reported it, that the idea was to have Bray Wyatt win and then for it to be Randy Orton versus Bray Wyatt for the championship at WrestleMania.
Hmm.
And that brings that story full circle because they'll have that build-up with the dissension between the two of them and all this sort of stuff. And it will break down before WrestleMania. And we'll get a great story out of it. Randy will win the championship,
mm-hmm.
Which I'm not cool with because I want Bray Wyatt to have a run with the belt.
Yeah.
But the fact that he's even going to win it, it makes me so happy. It's just so long overdue.
Agreed.
But Bray Wyatt.
I'm looking at the names here, thinking who else it could be. I don't think he's going to retain. AJ Styles would be great, but I don't think it's going to happen. Dean Ambrose.
He's the IC Championship.
Wouldn't make sense. The Miz. No. Baron Corbin has been getting a big push, but can too
you see
early.
Him, and can you see him fighting for the championship at WrestleMania?
No.
Can you see Bray Wyatt versus Randy Orton at WrestleMania, which we called months ago?
Yeah. It's got to be.
Never in my wildest imagination did I think that match would be for the championship at WrestleMania.
Yeah, same. It's got to be Bray, hasn't it?
Yep.
It's got to be Bray. We pretty much said the same thing through everything, apart from Luke Harper and Randy Orton.
Yeah, and I've gone for no one winning. Yeah. Luke Harper,
so. So yeah, I'm going to say Bray as well. Predictable, perhaps. This will be a pay-per-view, but cool, I think. It's going to be good. It's going to be good one.
Yeah, I mean, the build to WrestleMania after this, it could be excellent.
Yeah.
With Bray as the champion, it could be so good.
Oh, man.
I mean, we're going to have a good month and a half of build towards WrestleMania after this.
Yeah. We're going to get Bray Wyatt versus Cena at some point beforehand. Just for the rematch, to get out of the way.
Yep.
And AJ Styles needs a rematch as well at some point.
Yeah. So Bray could actually look like a real beast going into WrestleMania defending his championship.
Yeah.
Fuck, man. This is exactly what I've wanted from Bray Wyatt for years.
Yeah, seriously.
And it sucks that he's just going to go to WrestleMania and lose the fucking belt. Maybe he doesn't.
Maybe he doesn't. Maybe they keep it on him. Maybe. We'll see.
We'll see. But Bray Wyatt is going to win the belt.
Cool. Yeah, he is.
But I'm looking forward to seeing it.
Me too.
I'm looking forward to seeing him win the belt and then be the champion.
Yeah.
Long overdue, and hopefully this is the start of him having his own solo run without Wyatt family.
Hopefully.
And all that sort of stuff. It'd just be what we've wanted from Bray all along.
Yeah, just Bray.
Just Bray Wyatt being Bray Wyatt.
Exactly.
Being awesome. So Elimination Chamber is this Sunday, and we are back on YouTube this Sunday, youtube.com/SonnyFinnPlay,
yeah,
with our WWE Elimination Chamber 2017 prediction show live.
Woo.
Where we will be playing through the entire card on WWE 2K17.
Yep.
This has been the Games and Graps podcast. We are a weekly video game and wrestling podcast that posts nearly every single Friday across podcast services everywhere.
Except when our laptop breaks.
Yes. Which hopefully it won't again.
Yes, hopefully.
Go follow us on Twitter at Games and Graps. Go follow Daydreamer Gaming on Twitter at Daydreamer Gaming.
Mm-hmm.
Go subscribe to the Sonny and Finn Show on YouTube, youtube.com/SonnyFinnPlay, yep. Not the Sonny and Finn Show.
iTunes.
Do the same for Daydreamer Gaming on YouTube. Subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. Follow us on SoundCloud. And you can listen to the podcast pretty much anywhere else you want to.
Pretty much.
Lots of stuff. I'm going to have to get that right one day.
One day.
One day I'm going to just have a nailed on script for what I'm going to say at the end.
You're like an auto cue to beat off.
Yeah. Guys, thank you so much for listening to 50 episodes of the Sonny and Finn Show.
Yay.
And interacting with us on all social media and YouTube and all that sort of stuff. Thank you. And
yes,
here's the
you.
50 more.
Yes. Enjoy. Come back episode 100.
Yes, we'll see you in 50 episodes time. Well, we'll see you next week, but yeah, we'll still be here in 50 episodes time.
Yes, we will.
For now, I'm Sonny.
I'm Finn.
Enjoy Elimination Chamber, and we'll moan about it next week.
For sure.
Goodbye.
Thanks so much. Goodbye.
Wait.
Oh snap! The
wait.
It's been a week. We forgot. Oh my goodness.
Finn.
Hello.
This Ooh. Week's episode of the Games and Graps podcast
cool sound effects.
Is brought to you by the letter.
Jesus. Letters. Any letter. N for November.
Good, because I'm near that.
Hey.
I can alphabet.
Yay. I can't. I'm trying to think of any letter I hadn't already picked.
I like how WWE make tag teams up and just put new in front of it.
Oh yeah,
like they it's like they reinvent an old tag team but put new in front of it, so it seems new when it's not.
Nikolai Volkov.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
No mercy.
New Midnight Express, that you're talking about.
Yeah. New Midnight Express, new Rockers, new Blackjacks, new Age Outlaws. God, there isn't.
Nation Domination.
Nails. Oh, wait, hang on. We've already done Nails, I think.
Have we? I think we might have, actually, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we've done it before. Damn it.
Damn you, Nails. You know, this one is ridiculous enough. Let's go for the new Midnight Express.
Okay.
During the 80s, manager James E. Cornette led the Midnight Express, a constantly evolving tag team consisting of such superstars as beautiful Bobby Eaton, sweet Stan Lane, and lover boy Dennis Condrey. All great names, by the way.
Great names.
To tag team greatness in the NWA. A decade later, I didn't realise they released rap records, or the Midnight Express people.
I mean, neither.
A decade later, Cornette recreated the egotistical team in WWE. This time, though, he replaced its ageing members with considerably younger Bob Holly and Bart Gunn.
Ah, I know those two.
Yeah. Known as the new Midnight Express, original, nice. Holly and Gunn adopted nicknames fitting of the 80s squad. Holly became Bodacious Bob, while Gunn went by Bombastic Bart. The name changes, however, did little in the way of creating success. The duo failed to make any real waves in WWE. Their highest profile encounter came at WrestleMania 15, where they competed in the Tag Team Battle Royal, which was ultimately won by LOD 2000. Yeah. Also a terrible name.
Yeah, it's awesome.
By the end of 1998, less than 1 year into their existence, the new Midnight Express went their separate ways. Nice. For good reason.
Yes.
This week's episode of the Games and Graps podcast was brought to you by the letter N.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for listening to the podcast. We'll see you next week. Goodbye.
Yes, thank you very much. Goodbye.
Divas.